Go ahead and hit the record button. Okay, we're going to go ahead and get started. So everyone, welcome. This is our second day of the redesigned beginner training review, flash review, I guess I'm going to call it. A couple little housekeeping things first. Today, we're going to be going over the payroll process itself and the menus that basically kind of go along with the payroll processing portion. So we're going to talk about all that today. If anyone has a question, you could go ahead and unmute yourself. And I also have the chat window pulled up, so I'm going to try to keep an eye on that as well. If there's any questions, like I said, while we're going through, go ahead and ask. And we will try to get through this as painlessly as possible. I think we're good to start. If you hear a dog barking, I apologize. He's in the basement. I'm puppy sitting for my son, and I have two dogs. So if you hear a dog, don't be alarmed. You are hearing a dog. So we're going to go ahead and get started. What we're going to talk about first are some of the
webinar roll on it. So
okay, someone needs to mute. If not, I could just mute everyone. I'll go ahead and do that. Okay. All right, so we're going to go ahead and we're going to start with the basic like pre-payroll reports and things that need to be normally done for a district. Districts, anyone that has a new hire, a new employee, they usually submit a new hire report to ODJFS. We have that option available out here in the redesign. So I'm going to go ahead and show you where that report and the submission file can be created at. That's under reports. So if we go to reports, and down here at the bottom, we have an SCRS new hire report. We also have the we're talking about ODJFS. Scratch that. We got to go back. I'm already starting off bad here. So let's see, where are you? Here it is. Okay. We're going to go back. Okay. We're talking about new hire, which is ODJFS report. So we go to the ODJFS new hire report, click on that option. And when we do that, you can see I have a few new employees listed. So what it allows me to do, it allows me to generate a report that I can actually look at before I create a submission file. So I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to click that generate report option. And when I do that, that report is going to process, going to give me all the information for all my new hires. So as you can see, now the thing about any of the reports, don't panic when you don't see anything on them, because usually that first page is empty. And on the second page, here are my actual new hire employees. So it gives me their employee number, their name, and their hire date. So if I go back in, I want to actually create the submission file. I could click that generate submission file option. When I do that, it's going to create the submission file, which it allows me to tell it where I want it to go. So I can do save as type is already automatically defaulted to the correct format for ODJFS reporting. And one other thing too, these reports are all in the correct format, like ODJFS ones or SCRS ones or STRS ones, so that I can tell it wherever I want it to go on my computer, you know, in a folder, on my desktop, wherever I want it to go. So when I click that save option, it saves that file out to that particular folder, but then I can also view that CSV file before I actually submit it by just going in, and I'll pop that up real quick if I can get it to pull up. It's opening. Maybe. All right, so while that's opening, we're going to go back to reports. And again, we kind of talked about the same thing. Here's our ODJFS new hire, but we also have STRS and SCRS new hire, because those also have to be submitted as well. And it's the same format. I mean, you're basically going to go in, you can process a report, you can actually look at that report, and then you can actually create a submission file that you're going to actually upload to the entity that you're creating your report for. All right. So once we've done all that, now we're going to make sure that our posting period, because I'm going to go in, I'm going to actually show you a pay, I'm going to process it for March. Well, right now we can see, and Andrea probably talked about posting periods a little bit yesterday, but you can see over here to the right that I am currently set in the February posting period. So if I have all of my, everything that I need to have done for February, all my month-end stuff completed, everything submitted, I basically need to go in and create my new posting period, which would be for March. So I'm going to go to the core, and actually I think I've already created it in here, but we'll just go in and look at it. Pretend that we didn't. I'll just kind of go through the process. Oh, maybe I didn't. Thought I did. Okay. So anyway, this is my posting period currently is March. So I need to, or February. So I need to create the March posting period because I want to be in March posting period in order for me to be able to process. Now, when I want to process, if I wanted to go into future and add some future data or attendance or anything like that, I could actually do that if I had March period open. But in order for me to actually process the payroll itself, it has to be listed as current. So I'm going to go in here and I'm going to select March. And I'm going to select 2020. And I'm just going to make this my current posting period because I've already finished everything I have for February. And I want to go ahead and get ready and just start processing my payroll all the way through. Okay, so as you can see, February is still an open posting period. I left it open. I could actually close it. Okay, could you mute your phone? Let me go ahead and mute all again. I thought I did, but maybe not. Okay. All right. So I could go ahead and close February by just clicking on that little folder. And then if you look to the right, you can see now that February posting period is closed. It says fall. It's not open anymore. So now March is my only open and current posting period. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to go ahead and in the normal payroll processing world, what districts normally do is they can go out and they can start entering attendance if they manually enter it. They can actually enter future data if they wanted to do that. So what we can do is I will go out. I'm going to show you how to manually add some attendance first. We're going to just add a couple people for this payroll. So if I wanted to, I could use the core menu. So I'll show you the core menu and then also through the dashboard. So I'll go to the core menu first. I'm going to click on the attendance option. When I do that, it's going to pull up the attendance screen. As you can see, it now says attendance. So I'm going to go ahead and click the create option. Now, I want to make sure, because currently the way attendance is working, and there is actually a JIRA issue out there to fix this, but it's not working like Classic does, where Classic, if you have the option set to basically not adhere specifically to posting period or payroll periods, it would actually pull in, you know, if you had like timesheet data that was from a previous previous pay, and you actually added that attendance information now, the system currently isn't pulling that in. So basically, like for SCRS, you have to go out to ESRS and you have to make manual corrections, which in reality, you really should anyway, because it's from a prior posting period anyway. But fact of the matter is, it's not doing that in the system at all. So they actually are going to be correcting that to allow to pull in for, you know, other periods other than the one that we're processing right now. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to add an attendance record for an employee. So I'll just go ahead. Actually, I'm going to add an absence record. We'll do that. So I find my employee. I find the job. And then I'm going to put in the activity date. So my payroll is going to be from 3/1 to 3/14. So I have to choose a date within that, you know, pay period, which you normally would. So I'm just going to put 3120. And let's just say he was absent for one full day. So you can see the length and all, everything else is already defaulted. Now, if I was doing an attendance, I would have to go in and change that from an absence to an attendance, and then the category would change as well. So that's all I really need to process when I'm manually adding the attendance record. And if I needed to add another one for the same employee, I'm going to copy the row. But all I'm going to do, I'm just going to change the date. Maybe he was absent for 2 days. Well, not the 21st. Okay, so he's absent on 3-1 and 3-2. So I've got everything in that I want. I'm going to go ahead and click the save option to save that. Now, what I can also do if I'm adding attendance, and my guess is districts probably would want to use, if they're going to manually do it, use that attendance option, and then either just use that plus button to copy, you know, to create a new line entry, or they could actually add a new employee if they needed to, because that's a little bit easier. The other option in the attendance is this, oops, hold on, is the mass add option. The mass add option is really nice because, example, for the guy that I just added, I had put in 2 days. Well, maybe I could go into this and I could actually go in, and I'm going to go in here and find my employee, same way I did with the create option. And then the position automatically pops up to the first position. If he has other ones, there's a drop down. I could select the correct one. So I'm going to use the absence option because he was absent. But the nice thing about this is I could put a start and stop date in here, and it should populate or highlight these fields. Or I could just go down and highlight the days that he was absent. Maybe he was absent for 3 days. So I went in and highlighted the 3 days. All I need to do is click this create option. And when I do that, it's going to, well, is that going to tell me? Oh, this job isn't, okay, let me try a different job. I thought it was this job. Oh, I know what I did. I used a different database yesterday, and I actually created a leaves record for him, but I forgot. So let's just go back and do this for Corey Cox. The mass ad. I'm so sorry. I get myself confused on my databases, and I had updated the one yesterday, which was a different database, and I didn't update this one. Whoops. Okay. So we'll go ahead. We're going to add a couple more days for Corey because I know he will actually work. So we already added the first and second. So let's go in and we'll add the fifth and the sixth. And then I'm just going to go ahead. Like I said, if I hit the create, it's going to tell me that two absence records, these were attendance records, but they were absent. It said attendance, but they really are absent because it's marked as absent. Okay. So if I go to the attendance screen, I can see now there's four absences sitting out there for Corey, which are the ones that I added. Like I said, You could add them like this manually if you needed to, or you could use the dashboard like Andrea would have shown you yesterday. There's a dashboard option which basically has the same thing. You pull up the employee, you just pull up your employee, and then once you do that, it'll actually have the list of all the different screens that you can access. And the attendance option is the screen, and you'll see those same options as far as create or mass add in that as well. The other option that you have is if districts use the kiosk or maybe ASOP, and they have a spreadsheet in the correct format, which is the same format that was used in Classic. So if they have the spreadsheet all set up with that same format, they could actually use that to import the absence or attendance data in without having to do manual entry. So once they've done that, they could actually go in and they've got their file, their CSV file that they need to import into the redesign. They're going to go to the utilities option. In the utilities option, there's an attendance absence import option. So if they have like two spreadsheets or one spreadsheet with everything on it, they could go in, find where their file is located, whether it's their desktop or a folder or wherever, and then if they use the location code, if they have that specified on the spreadsheet, they're going to want to go in and select the location code, whether it's building IRN or building department code, or if there is no location code on the spreadsheet, they can just choose the none option. Now, if they're posting to payroll, which would be only for attendance, if they were posting attendance information and then they wanted to post to payroll as well, since the current payroll isn't initialized, they could post to future if they wanted to right now because we don't have anything. So we could choose the post to payroll future option if they post to payroll when they're uploading attendance. If they wanted to combine attendance entries, so basically if an employee is on the spreadsheet and maybe they have like three different days that they work, but they want to combine all of those into one entry, they would just click this combine attendance entry box. If you're loading absences and attendance all at the same time and you want to allow negative leave balances, so basically anybody that has an absence on there, let's just say maybe they're going to go into the negative. If you don't have anything set up that you know stops it from doing that, you could click on the allow negative leave balance box. And then the payroll account to charge would be for your account that you want to charge if you're using the leave projection option. So, or basically, if you're loading future data as far as the attendance information, what account you want to charge to. So the defined payroll account for position means you have the employee, the sub or whatever that you're loading attendance for, entered in the system. You also have a payroll account defined for that employee. Do you want to use that account? Or if you entered information in the sub for SSN field in the attendance, or you loaded it through kiosk, or you know from the kiosk or ASOP, you could choose the sub for SSN field, and then it would actually charge the account that the employee that they sub for would charge that account. You basically have the option to do all that, and when you do all that, you're going to go ahead and click the import option. When you click the import option, then you're actually going to be importing the spreadsheet data, going to pull over into the attendance screen. So that's kind of a nice feature. A lot of people already use that, so it's really good. If not, you know, they can still do manual entry if they have to, or, you know, they have late time slips, they can do manual entry as well. Once they've done all this, once they've loaded all the data for their attendance and their absences, they can actually go in and run a report or two reports. If they wanted like separate absence, separate attendance, they could do that. So all they have to do is go to the reports menu, and under report manager, there's an option out there. It's an SSDT report. It's an SSDT attendance journal report. Even though it says attendance, you can still pull in absences. So we're going to go ahead and we'll process this. I should have actually done attendance as well. I didn't do that. But it's basically the same thing. You'll see the save and record. We're going to talk about all this stuff tomorrow when we talk about reports. So I'm not going to go into it a great deal today. But on this report, you can see that the report options, I can choose it by format, by size, the name. If I wanted to rename it something different, maybe I was doing absences and attendance. Or since I just only added absences, I'm just going to make this my absence journal report. All right. Now, my next option I have to go to is my query option, because basically I don't want to pull everything in from the month or everything for, you know, the whole month of March. I could use the MA for the month if I wanted to, because it's the beginning of the month. It's the first payroll. It would work. But I want to put my specific dates in. So I'm going to use my 3-1 of 20 through the 3-14 of 20. And then I'm going to go down. I could, you know, specify the job status or appointment type if I wanted. But all I want are my absences. So I'm just going to type in, if I can tell you, absence. Okay. So I'm going to go ahead and process this report. My sorting options, I could go in and tell it how I want the report to sort. Currently, it's sorting by employee number and activity date. So I basically don't want the number to be sorted by. Let's just do activity date. So I'm going to pull this back over here. And then I want the full name. So I'm going to sort by full name. Oops. Maybe. And then once I've done that, I've gotten to how I want it. I want to sort by the activity date. So the activity date is now, I don't want that first. Let's do this. Let's switch these around. I forget how this thing works. Hold on. Oh, I know how it works. Yeah, I have to pull this back over here and then pull it up here. There we go. Okay, so I want to sort by full name first and the activity date. So I'm going to go ahead now and I'm going to generate my report. Now, all we really are probably going to see on here are the absences that I just entered in for Corey Cox. So I'm going to go ahead and pull up my absence report. And we can see that Corey is on my report with those 4 days that I had entered in. So again, if you wanted to do both attendance and absence, if you want to do them separate, it's however the district wants to process those reports, they can do that. The next option that they're going to be using is they're probably going to be adding in time slip data. So they could actually use the future option to do that. So we're going to go in to the payroll tab at the top. And if you click on the down arrow, you'll see there's a current, a future, and a payroll processing. Well, I want to actually start entering my future data, so my time slip data, or anything, you know, any other data that employees may have worked. That like regular employees that have extra days, maybe Saturdays or Sundays, or they work extra in the evening. So that's just like up to Cal Future in Classic. So I'm going to go ahead and click this payments future option. And once I do that, I can actually start going in and entering my future data. So I'm going to go ahead and click the create option. When I do that, you'll see it's basically allowing for only one record at a time. But if I have an employee, let's just say I want to enter multiple records, I could go in and click this create new tab or this box. When I do that, what's going to happen is I'm going to enter an entry for him, and then I'm going to go in, I want to add another one. Well, once I enter the first one, it'll clear everything out and allow me to add another entry for that same person. So I'll kind of show you how that works. I'm just going to pick on old Corey Cox here. All right, so we're going to use the compensation one. And then we're just going to put like extra hours. And again, since he's a regular paid employee, I don't want to pay him using a regular pay type. I want to use a miscellaneous pay type because we just want to pay him the extra money, but we don't want that to go towards his contract. So if I wanted to, I could put the effective date in. If I leave that blank, it's automatically going to pull in. If I use the effective date for this pay period would be 3/1 through 3/14 because those are the period beginning and ending. So any day within that period, I could use. We do not want to use the pay date. And then I'm going to put in the number of units that he worked. Let's just say he worked 2 units. And we'll say he makes $30 an hour. Oops. And then if this payment applies for retirement, it needs to go towards retirement, I leave this box checked. It's automatically defaulted. And unless you uncheck it, you know, it'll actually go towards retirement or part of the payment will, retirement money will come out. And then the number of retire hours. If I had a specific, well, I should go back. If it was for a supplemental job, I would check the supplemental box. And then if it was, I would have to choose my supplemental taxing option as well. This isn't a supplemental, so I'm not going to go ahead and choose it. I'm just going to uncheck it. Now, if for some reason he was being paid out of a different pay account, like a specific miscellaneous pay account, I could go down here and click this plus box. And then I could actually enter in the expenditure account information that I want to pay him out of for this particular job or this particular activity that he did by basically going in and choosing my fixed or percent, whether it's a fixed amount or percent amount, then to the expenditure account. This is just like when you go into the expenditure account to create a pay account. If you started typing in a few characters of an expenditure account, it starts narrowing it down. Or if you know the account, you could type it all in. Or if you don't, you could keep typing in the information and it'll just keep narrowing it down. And it did. So basically, I could just click on that account then. And then I need to put in the amount to charge. If it's a fixed amount, I have to put in the amount that he's being paid. If I put in percentage, I could just use 100. And then we have to tell if it's subject for leave projection, and also is it subject to employer distribution. If it is, we leave these defaulted as checked. If not, we can uncheck them. Once we've created the information, we click the save option. When we save it, you can see Corey is still here with his same job, but this is going to allow me to actually add another entry if I wanted to. If I didn't want to, I could exit out. I'll just click close, or I'll unclick create new, then click close. Now I'll just go ahead and exit out of here. Okay, so basically I entered information in for Corey for this one day, but if I needed to add more, I could have. Instead of, you know, like exiting out, going back in, it allows you to keep creating information for that employee. Once I've got all of my future information in, we do have a future report that you can run now. I'm going to show you a couple different options. If they wanted to, the district could go in on the grid and pull in what they want to show, like on a report, if they wanted to do that. I'm just going to leave everything the way I have it right now. I don't even know what I have pulled up. But I'm going to go ahead and click this report option. So basically, I'm going to go into the report, and I'm going to tell it the format that I want it. Maybe I want it in a CSV format. I could choose that format. And then my page size, my orientation, if I want to name it, you know, something different than future pay amount report, because that's the default, I could name it, you know, maybe the payroll date. So 3/20/20 future pay amount report. We have a summary report or show report options page. The show report options page, we'll talk about that. That's basically just like we have in Classic, where if you wanted the page that the setup page printed out first, it'll do that. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to click this click the generate report option. Can't talk today. And then again, I can tell it where I want to save the file or the report to. And then if I pull up that report, I should be able to see, I would see all the entries that I entered in future. And then it should give me totals as well. Maybe. Come on. Why is this not pulling up? Hold on here. Let me try it again. All right, let's do this. Well, that didn't work. Okay, so let me go to my downloads and I can show you the actual report, because I want you to see the report, what they look like. Let's see. Here we go. I'll go ahead and pull it over. Ruger, quiet. All right, what is happening? None of my reports want to open up. Well, oh, it's spinning. Sorry, it's just taking a while for some reason. I don't know why. Okay. Anyway, let's continue on. Hopefully this report will pull up so I can show it to you, along with the absence journal, which I have sitting here too. It didn't pull up. They pulled up, of course, yesterday when I was testing it. Okay, so anyway, again, you could process a report right from the grid if you wanted to. You could also go out under reports. There's an option under there, under the report manager. Ruger, It's down here. It's called SSCC Future Pay Amount Report. I'm going to go ahead and click that option. And you'll kind of notice a pattern. You'll see this kind of the same setup that I had on the grid report. But this gives you query options. So I could, if I wanted to, put beginning and ending dates in. So basically, this would be like if you were using the effective date field in future, you could actually pull information using that. Or if you want a particular pay groups, you could enter those in as well. I'm just going to go ahead and click the generate report option. I'm not sure why these are not pulling up. I could rename it, 3/2020 future report and save it. There we go. Okay. Hooray, you have one pulled up. Okay. So this is, like I said, this actually gives me all the information that's up from future. So we've got the employee's information, the pay information, the dollar amount that we're paying him. It gives you a grand total of everything that you process through future. Also gives you the information as far as if it applies for retirement or not, and the accounts that are being paid out of, and whether their employer distribution, leave projection accounts, and how much is being paid out of that account. Excuse me, hold on one second. Okay. All right. So these are, like I said, there's a couple different ways you could run a future report if you needed to, the grid or through report. Our next process, once we've got the attendance and the absences entered in, all of our future data is entered in, we can actually go in now and we can initialize the payroll. So I'm going to go ahead. And what I have to do is I have to go to, again, back to that payroll tab at the top and click the payroll processing option. All right, so once I do that, one little tidbit I'll just kind of show you. You can see there's two tabs. There's an in-progress tab. There's also a posted tab. So the posted tab basically will show you any payroll that's been processed, whether it be from Classic when you do the import of the data, or if they process it through Redesign. And if I click the detail tab over here, it actually gives me information regarding that payroll that was processed, as far as like what the pay date was, beginning and ending date. And if I wanted to, I could actually go back in and take a look at the pay report for that particular payroll. If I wanted to look at the payroll item detail report, I could do that. I could just click that tab and pull it up. If I needed to send an email notice, a direct deposit email notice to somebody again, I could go into that. I could just click the email notices option, go in there. And once I do that, I could click only the employee that I want to send the notice for. So what I need to do to get rid of everybody else, because right now you see everyone is pulled into the selected. If I click the top person, then I hold the shift button and I go down to the bottom, it should highlight everybody, which it did. And then I can just move everyone over to the available option. Then I have the capability of just choosing the employee I want to resend the direct deposit notice to, so they're out there. And then again, I would choose the bank account. And if I use a special form for my direct deposit, I would choose that from this direct deposit form option. And then I would just click schedule sending of email direct deposit. So again, it's really nice. You could just resend an email direct deposit. If you needed to reprocess checks for some reason, you could go into the process payments option and you could do that as well. Get a file and then import over to your check printing software and print the check or check box that you need. So those are nice features where you can actually go to the previous payrolls and do things like that. But we're going to go in as I regress here, we're going to go back in and we're going to go back to the payroll. There we go. I just hit the return payroll listing. So now you can see I have my two tabs. I wanted to do where it says in progress. I'm going to click this initialize new payroll option. And when I do that, it's going to pop up a box. So basically, it gives me all the options I need to set up for the payroll I'm going to process. So I can type in whatever payroll description I want. So I'm going to call this my 3/20/20 payroll. And then I have to tell it whether my pay plan is biweekly or semi-monthly or monthly. You have those options. The pay cycle, is it the first pay of the month, second pay, second of a three pay, third pay of the month? This is my first pay of the month. Then I have to put in my beginning date of the payroll and my ending date of the payroll. And I have to put in my pay date. Oops. All right, now over here on the right, you can see we have this suppress voluntary deductions, ignore direct deposits, special pay. Those are all features. We do have those in classic, but those are, again, options. If you wanted to run just a special pay, you would just check that box. And then it basically does the same thing classic does. It creates a blank set of files where you actually have to go in and enter information into current in order to get the information into the payroll. If we wanted to ignore direct deposits, maybe you have some sort of a bonus that you're paying all of your teachers. Well, you could actually go in and click that ignore, I'm sorry, I'm going ahead of myself here. Ignore direct deposits. So maybe the bank needed to have the file, or the district needed to have the file to the bank by noon yesterday. Well, they didn't meet the deadline. So now instead of direct deposits, they have to give everyone checks. They're going to go in here and click that ignore direct deposit option. And that will actually produce all checks for all the employees. The third thing, which I was going to talk about earlier, is the suppress voluntary deductions, which is like, again, if teachers were getting a bonus and you didn't want to withhold any voluntary deductions, like their insurance or a 457 or 403B, anything like that, you're going to click the suppress voluntary deductions option. So none of the voluntary deductions are withheld. Since we're running a regular payroll, I'm not going to be checking any of it. But I do have the capability of going in, just like in classic, of going in and adding additions, which basically means if I have pay groups that are on different pay schedules, like period beginning and ending date, but they have the same pay date, I can actually go in and initialize my payroll to run it for everybody that basically has the period beginning and ending date of 3/1 through 3/14. And then anyone that has additions or basically different period beginning and ending dates, I could actually add them to the payroll after I get my initial payroll process. So I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to choose a couple different pay groups to not pull in to the initial run. So I'm going to choose the Violet 10 and the Maroon 4, because I'm going to process those later. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead, all of these pay groups here are the ones that I've got selected. So I'm going to go ahead and initialize the payroll, because I want to process everybody for 3/1 through 3/14 from all of these pay groups. Now, to the right, you'll notice the status bar or box, column, whatever, and you'll see these green indicator lights. That means that pay group has processed successfully. If you get a red indicator, which we didn't, which is good, but if you did by chance, more than likely there's an error, which is a fatal error on the report, on the error report. And what you would have to do is go into this error report option, and you would go in and it would actually tell you, it would say error. That means fatal. On classic it says fatal, but in here it just says error. But all of these are just warnings. And so warnings, you really don't have to worry about them. But if there was something here that said severity error, that has to be fixed because the payroll will not complete or move on until it's been corrected. So let's just say if you did have an error and you needed to make a correction, maybe you needed to make a correction to somebody's compensation record. Maybe there was something wrong with it. So you went in, made the correction. What you could actually do, instead of reinitializing the whole payroll, what you should be able to do is just click this modify payroll option. And like I said, if that status button was red, you would go over to that particular pay group and you would check the box next to it. Because basically what you did, you updated the compensation record. Now you want to modify that pay group to get that person into the payroll. You want to get them included. So you would click the box just next to that pay group, and then you click the update payroll option. You can see across the top, there's a blue line that's processing. And then you'll see the initialization. So you can see that the indicator is spinning, meaning basically it's making updates. So if that had been red, I mean, I made the changes and I made the update, now my indicator button should be green. Again, can't go anywhere if your indicator button is red. You've got to make corrections. So luckily, my indicator button is green. All right, so you can see that I have 121 employees included in this payroll. All right, so the next thing we're going to do is we want to go in and we want to make sure we add those two other pay groups that we want in there, but they have different period beginning and ending dates. So I'm going to go ahead and click this add pay group option. And when I do, you can see that those are the only two that are available. So I'm going to go ahead and just pull them over. I can pull them over by clicking on the name and then right-clicking the arrow. Or I should be able just to double-click it. Maybe. Yes. And it moves over to the selected box. All right. So now both of them are in my selected box. And then I'm going to go in and tell them enter in the start date and stop date for those particular pay groups. Now I could enter the dates in or I can use the calendar. And I want to use the calendar because I'm not really sure what dates I want to use. So I'm going to use February 23rd through March 7th, let's just say. Actually, no. Let's go back. I got to fix this. March 14th, the last day of the payroll. Okay. So I'm going to go ahead and click the add pay group option. When I do that, you can see again, it's initializing, it's pulling those pay groups in. You can see those pay groups up here. You can see the indicator is green and it's also initializing. So basically pulled those pay groups in without error because my payroll status is green, basically meaning I can move on. So once I've done that, I can actually go in and start pulling up reports. These are basically just, I want to call them like projection reports, like reports that basically give me information for the projection report. So granted, if nothing changes between now and the time that I post the payroll, the reports aren't going to change, okay? So let's go in and I'm actually going to go and let's pull up, we did the error report. Let's pull up the pay report first because the pay report, just like in Classic, is a report of all the employees that are included in this payroll, and it gives me totals at the bottom as far as like how much is going to go in direct deposit, how much is going the gross for the total payroll, everything. I'm going to go to my setup screen for the pay report. You can see if I wanted to call this a different name, I could. I could call it the 3/20/20 initial. Payroll report. And then I could choose my sorting options. Well, how do I want to sort those reports? I just want to sort it by last name. But you can see there's several different sorting options on this report that you can use. And then what type of format do I want to use? I'm going to keep it as a PDF, but you can see, again, there's all different options as far as format for the report. And then do I want to be getting each employee on a new page? Probably not. I include the employer payroll items amount, which is the board distribution amount. And you can see that that's defaulted, which is a good thing. Now, if they didn't, for some reason, didn't want that on there, they could uncheck this box. And then our last thing is show only report totals. I'm not going to do it because I want to see everything for the employees right now. So I'm going to go ahead and click this generate report option. And when I do that, I should get my pay report for my my March 20th payroll. And you can see the indicator. It takes a few minutes because there's a lot of data being pulled into this report. It doesn't take too long, depending on how many employees you're paying. You know, if you have a very large district, it might take a few minutes. But normally with like 125, like we have, shouldn't really take all that long to process this report. Okay, so the report is finished. I'm going to go ahead and pull it up. All right, so you can see here, this is my payroll information, beginning, ending date, and pay date. This pretty much looks like our setup screen, and then it gives me all of my pay group ranges by date. So you can see that my maroon, four, and violet have different dates than my other pay group. All right, and then we can go down here, and this is where we see all the employee information, each employee's information. And then at the bottom of the report, let's go to the bottom here, maybe. Okay, at the bottom of the report, this is where we have all of the payroll item information. As far as like what was paid to which payroll item, we got all the pay group information. We have pay group totals and then grand totals at the bottom of those pay groups. And then up here, we have our report summary. We have our total gross, our total net, total amount charged, our direct deposit total. We have total employees, total positions that were paid, payroll item total, and annuity total. How many females were paid? And this was a big thing because a lot of people have been asking for it. It's finally here. So how many female employees were paid and how many certified employees were paid? Those numbers are all listed on that report now. So if everything balances out, if everything looks correct on your report, we could actually go back to our main screen of the payroll. And we can actually then look at the budget distribution report. Now this, again, is just the initial report. It's not the report that you're actually going to be giving to the treasurer. You can see we have the same capability of going in here, and we have the option to enter a different report title, different name for the report. And then we have our different format options. If I generate this report, it's going to give me all the budget information regarding this payroll. I'm going to save this. And that report is quite quick. It doesn't usually take very long. And again, if you see a blank page, don't panic because usually there's data. If there's no data in the report, it'll tell you on the very first page, no data found. But you can see here, this gives a list of all the different budget accounts and all the dollar amounts that were expended to those accounts. And at the bottom of the report, it gives you a summary. It gives you a total for each different fund, and then the total dollar amount coming out of each fund. And then the budget amount, the grand total for the budget. Our next report is the pay account distribution report. And this is actually going to give you all the information regarding each individual employee. Again, you have the capability of calling this report whatever you want to call it, but the default is the payroll account distribution detail report. Again, I could call it like the 32020 initial payroll account distribution report. I want it in PDF format. I'm going to go ahead and click this generate report option. When I do that, I should be able to pull that report up. And you can see each employee listed under each budget that has been charged, each account, expenditure account has been charged. You can see all the information for each account with the employee name on it. And then at the bottom of the report, if I can get down there, there we go. Again, it gives you total for the summary for the fund and then the total of all funds combined. And actually that total should be matching what your total was on your pay report. Then we have your, where are you? I must have passed it. Oh, I did. I'm sorry. I skipped one. This is why I want to look at the payroll item detail report. This is basically the payroll items or the deductions that were paid on this payroll only. So we're going to go ahead and I'm going to call it the 320 initial payroll item detail report. I can sort however I want by employee number or by employee name. I'm going to choose name. Now, if I went in and selected a particular payroll item, it would only give me that item on the report. If I left the selected blank, it's going to give me every payroll item that was paid on this payroll. And that's normally what I do. A lot of districts may only want to see particular payroll items. They would just select that particular payroll item. Just pull it over to the selected box and then run the report for that. But I'm not going to do that. I'm going to run it for everything. Maybe, no. All right. So what I'm going to do is click the generate report option. When I do that, it's going to go ahead and process all of the payroll items. Now, one thing I was going to tell you too, if you're on any, you know, on your system, you have a test database, if you have a district data, you'll notice that a lot of times when you're processing anything that works, whether it does anything with payroll items, it seems like it takes a little bit. Now, this is, that was good. But if it does, the reason being, when you first go in, it's collecting so much information, so much data, that it takes a few extra minutes. But once you've gone in initially and pulled up maybe the payroll item screen, or like this, you're doing a report that encompasses payroll items. When you do that, after you've done it initially and you go back in, you'll notice that it's a lot quicker. It will be because you've actually accessed the payroll items one time. So it's, and they are working on that. They're going to try to get that so it's a little bit better. But I just wanted to kind of make note of that. Let's make you aware of that. So here is our initial payroll item detail report that we just processed. And again, it's going to contain all of my information for this payroll. So maybe I wanted to go in, I want to take a look at my 400s and my 450s and my Medicare and make sure that everything is balancing out. I can do that through this report. I could go in and take the totals and I can actually make sure that everything is in balance before I continue on. And like I said, it gives you all the employee names, everybody that has been paid and paid into a payroll item on this payroll. All right, so we've gone through all the reports that are created when you've initialized the payroll. So we had the pay report, the payroll item detail report, the budget distribution report, the pay account distribution report. There's also the error report. So if you had errors, that's the first place that you have to go initially. Once we've gone in and verified everything, okay, our pay report looks good. I'm happy with the totals, happy with the way everything came out, looks great. Everything looks good on the payroll item detail report. The budget and pay account summary or pay account distribution report all match. Everything looks great. I'm happy with the way the payroll is going. I can go ahead now and click this post payroll option. Now, when I say post payroll, you think of classic and you're like, oh, I posted the payroll to USPS. That's not what we're doing. When we're clicking the post payroll option here, we're just posting it in the payroll system. We're not posting it to USAS yet, okay? Which basically means if I go ahead and click the post payroll option, I can go ahead and post, and you can see I have my indicator basically telling me that it's processing because it's spinning around. And hopefully, when it gets completed, that should be green, meaning the posting was successful. Now, if it wasn't, you're going to get a post error report. Again, you have to go in. I didn't get a post error report because I didn't have any errors. But if I did have errors, you would get a post error report, which you need to look at. And a lot of districts get confused. They have to make sure, because if this was red, if my indicator was red, there would be another report here, say post error report. They have to make sure that they go in and look at that report instead of this report, instead of the error report, because the error report isn't going to tell them what happened when they were posting, what errored out when they were posting. So they just have to be aware of that. But you can see again, a lot of these reports are similar to what we just saw. Our pay report, it'll be the same. The totals on it should be the same. Our payroll item detail report, that will be the same. Budget distribution report isn't. So this is a report, the districts can still go in and pull up the reports if they want to and verify the totals to make sure if they want. That's their prerogative. But they want to make sure that they go into this budget distribution report after they posted the payroll. And the reason being, I'm going to call this one my final budget distribution report. You'll notice on this, it has a USPS check number and USPS vendor number. Those can be ignored right now. They shouldn't be on the UI at all. They are going to go ahead and remove them, but it's something that's not critical right now. It's just something that can be ignored. You don't have to put anything in there. So I just basically am going to leave both of them blank. And when I click the generate report option, what's going to happen is it's going to give me the report. But this is the report that I'm going to actually be giving to the treasurer because it has the treasurer's signature data at the bottom of the report. So I'll go ahead and pull it up. And you can see at the bottom, here's our treasurer's certificate information. They have to sign date it. And so we're probably going to be printing this report off and giving it to the treasurer. And again, we have the pay account distribution report as well, if they wanted to go ahead and look at that. Again, they could go in and open all of these reports and save them to their folder or desktop, just rename them to like final. Like I did, and I did the beginning ones I did initial because those were all my initial reports. Then I actually could go in here and open all these and save them to my folder and call them the final pay report, final payroll item detail report, et cetera. So at this point, I've looked at all of my reports. I've saved all my reports. Okay. If I wanted to, I could say, oh, darn. Somebody just brought in a time slip and I want to include it on this payroll, which a lot of districts might just say, too bad, so sad, you're going to get paid next time. But you could actually go in and unpost the payroll. You could do that. If they unpost the payroll, what they could do, click the unpost payroll option. And it takes a few seconds because there's a lot of data that you're actually moving back. So we're going to go ahead and unpost the payroll. And you can see the indicator. It basically went back, which is good. So let's just say that our buddy Corey, he had brought in his other time slip because he forgot, oh, I worked these extra hours as well. I could go back in here to the payroll, but I could go to current, and I could actually add the other, some more pay information for Corey since he brought it in. I feel like I'm being nice today, so I'm going to go ahead and just put the information so I can get it done on this payroll. So I'm going to go ahead and create it. Actually, before I do that, let's do this. Since he worked, let's say he worked Saturdays and Sundays. I need to enter attendance too. I'm going to go to the attendance screen. And I'm going to post it to current. All right. So we're going to go in here. takes a few seconds. I'm going to create the attendance, plus I'm going to post the information to current all in one swoop. So the first thing I need to do is say I want to post the payroll. So I need to go to this post to current option. And then you can see another little box pops up. It says select current payroll for posting. I have to make sure I tell it which payroll, which is the 320 payroll. So I'm going to select that. So that's all done. That's selected. Now I'm going to go in here. And I'm going to go ahead and enter the information for him. Corey. And let's just say that he worked on 313. I think that's a Saturday. So I want to make sure I could use my calendar. No, it wasn't. It's a Friday. Actually, let's put the 8th. He worked on Sunday, the 8th. We want to change this transaction type to attendance. And then he also worked, go back down here. Now, if I click the plus, you'll see that it actually just pulled up a blank screen. But I don't want that. I'm going to exit. I'm going to get rid of that and click the copy row because all I want to change is the date. Everything else is the same. I just want to change the date. So I'm just going to go back into the calendar. And he worked, maybe he worked on the 14th. So I'm going to go in. I have my post current with my pay date selected. I'm going to click the save option. And that's going to give me a pop-up box. And it's going to say, hey, do you want to post this future? Right here. Gives me this information. Here's his rate. It pulls the rate that he has on his screen, the account number, all the information. So if all of this is accurate, you can see both of these are checked because it's basically saying, yep, I want to pull both of these into current. So I'm going to go ahead and click the post selected records to current. So I should, and it gives me a message box saying two records were posted to current. And then if I go out here to the payroll, I should be able to go in and find Corey and find those two entries that we just put in. So I'm going to go into current just because I'm curious. I want to make sure. And you can see right here. Whoops. I'm jumping ahead of myself. Let me find him here. Okay. Pull up. Oh, shoot, I pulled the wrong job. Sorry. Hold on. Got to do the other job. It was job 1, job 4. Okay, it's this one. Yep, you can see both of the entries that we just posted. 340.91, 340.91. Those are the entries that we posted from attendance. So now what I have to do is go in and basically process just like I would have if I had just initialized the pay. So remind your district, if they go in and unpost the payroll, that they're going to want to go in, because if they unposted, there is a reason they unposted. Maybe they had to make a correction to something. If they did, they have to basically process those reports again and pretty much process everything they've done at that point, because everything that they did is not really accurate because they unposted it and made corrections or redid something. So we're going to go in and click the payroll process and go back in here, click the detail. All right, so at that point, they're going to want to run a new pay report because Corey, on their initial pay report, he's not on there with all that information with those 2 days. So let's go back in. And we'll process this, and we'll take a look at Corey, and more than likely, he better have 2 extra days on his report, on the report. So let's go in and look at him here. Something I'll tell you too while we're talking. When we're talking about unposting the payroll, districts can actually go in and unpost. Let's just say that they've gone through the entire posting of the payroll. They've actually gone out and processed payments. They've actually gone out and set up the email direct deposit notices to go to be released sometime. If they've done that, they could still go in and unpost the payroll. But again, like I said, with that happening, if they've gone in and added new data, they basically have to run through all the processes again, run all the reports again. They would have to go back in and rerun the check again. They'd want to go back in and set up the email direct deposit notices again, because like I said, Corey's is going to be different. And the nice thing about that is, I'll show you in a few seconds here, how they can actually go in and get rid of that initial job that they put out there for the email direct deposit. They could actually do that. And then they could go in and just reprocess the email direct deposit, setting it for the same date and time if they wanted to. So I'm going to go ahead and pull up my pay report that I processed. And Corey should be on here with the additional amount that he. Okay. And we can see here, he's got two entries. Actually, there's two entries, but you can see there's a problem, because in reality, these should have been miscellaneous pays. They post it as regular pay, so that's going towards the job. So really what I should do is go into current and change that to miscellaneous. I'm not going to do it because it's just going to take up our time. But when you're posting from attendance, it is using the regular. And I'm thinking that we do have an issue out there to fix that, to allow you to actually put in, you know, a miscellaneous or an overtime or something like that, other than having to go into current and actually change it on the screen, actually be able to do it right before you're posting out of attendance. We have a gear issue out there to do that. So I'm going to go ahead. Actually, no, I'm going to go ahead and fix it because I want to show you something. Anything that's made, a change is made, like on the current screen or in a payroll item or something like that, it's automatically updated on the fly. So when I just pull up the pay report, it's going to show. So let me just go in to current and change this. And then change those regulars to miscellaneous. So let's pull him up. And it was job one. All right, so I just wanted to change this from regular to miscellaneous, and then this one as well from regular to miscellaneous. Yep, okay, once I've done that, I'm going to save those changes. And again, all I have to do is go into the pay report, and I should be able to see those changes were made on the fly. They happen automatically. And same thing for payroll items. If you've gone into a payroll item, made a change, rerun the pay report, it's there. In current, you just have to go in and delete the up-to-date current record, then re-add it, and then you can see it on the pay report. Here, it's just a matter of making the correction and then running the pay report. So let me go ahead and rerun it again. All right, we're going to go ahead and generate it, and we'll pull that up. And when we do, Corey should then show the two miscellaneous pays instead of the two regular. This is a really nice thing about the redesign as far as like being able to unpost. In the past, you know, districts used to have to call you and say, hey, I messed up. Can you restore my data back before, you know, I ran pager or check update. We could do that, but it was a process. Where here, you don't even have to get involved unless they call you and ask you about it. But other than that, I mean, you don't have anything to do as far as like restoring their data back to before they post a check update. So let me find Corey again. One thing you'll see, I was doing a search on the pay report to find somebody. All I do is hit control and the F key to get that pop-up box, so I can then type in what I'm searching for. And now you can see, here's Corey. Now he's got those miscellaneous. That's what I wanted to see. So he is in good shape. We're good with that. So once everything's correct on my pay report, like I want it to be, again, I could go back in. I'm probably going to go back in. I'll probably be rerun all these reports because he's getting paid more money, or if he was getting paid less, the budget report's going to be different, the pay account report's going to be different, the payroll item detail report could be different. So I'm going to process all those reports again. And then once I've done that, I'm going to go in here. Before I click post payroll, I want to show you something too. You can see we have two options out here, a delete payroll option and a delete payroll and exceptions option. What that means is the delete payroll option will actually just delete this entire payroll. But if you basically had anything added in future or current, all of that data should actually get thrown back over into future. Even if you did entries into current, all of that would go into the future screen. So when you initialize again, it should all pull into the current payroll. Now, if you do the delete payroll and exceptions option, anything that you entered in current manually, so like those entries for Corey, if I had manually entered those in current with miscellaneous pay, and I do the delete payroll and exceptions, you know, I did those in current. If I did the delete payroll and exceptions, those are going to be gone. They're not going to go over to the future pay. They're going to be wiped out. Anything that was in future should go back to future, I'm pretty sure. But anything that you put in current would be gone. So those are two nice things. So if the district is just like not happy with the way that payroll process, they could go in and delete the whole thing and start over if they wanted to. And like I said, anything they entered in current and everything that was in future would already automatically go over to the future. I'm going to go ahead and click post payroll because I want to post this payroll again since I made those corrections. And actually, now that we're talking about it, we talked about all the different pay reports that we're going to reprocess because we added those entries for Corey. Since we added those two new attendance days, you could rerun an attendance report as well from the reports menu, just like we did before, selecting the particular days. It should then include those additional 2 days that we added. All right, so we can see that the payroll posted successfully because we have the green indicator light. Now we have our final pay report. We have a final error report, which is basically the same as what we saw before on the error report when we did the initial. It's the same exact thing. I'll pull it up so you can see it. Should just be all those warnings that we saw initially. And it is. But again, if you had a posting error, it's going to be a red indicator light, and you're going to have a post error report in this process. And we're going to probably redo all of these reports as well as final. Redo the final budget detail report so you can give a corrected one to the treasurer. Then once we've done that, we can actually go in and click the process payments option. The process payments option is basically going to give you a file for any check or direct deposits or anything that you need to process out. So we'll go ahead, click the process payments feature. It takes a second for this to pop over. Okay, now if we do, let's say direct deposits first. I'm going to do direct deposits, and I'm going to choose my format. I want to choose the XML format because if we print up any direct deposit notices, they go over to our printing software in XML. And then we have to choose the bank account. So if the district has more than one bank account, maybe they have a bank account that pays just the payroll, and then they have another bank account that pays just the payroll item, the deduction. They would have to choose which bank account they're going to be paying these checks out of or the direct deposits out of. Then you can choose your sorting option. And again, you can see there's a variety of sorting options. Now, the key thing the district has to remember to do, they have to remember to click this print all direct deposits option. If they don't click that, the file is going to be absolutely blank. They're not going to see anything on the file at all. So you've got to make sure that they click that print all direct deposits option. Then there's a file name, which is automatically defaulted to directdeposits.xml. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to click this process payments option. when I do that, it's giving me the XML file. And again, I could tell it wherever I wanted to put it. If I have a, you know, software folder that I want to put it in and import it into the software, I could do that. You can still see that it's still processing because the indicator button here is still spinning. But once that's finished, that direct deposit form will be an XML format, and I can actually import it into my printing software at that point. Maybe. And then you can see we also have a PDF option as well, which basically means you're going to be able to print the direct deposit straight from the file that gets created. And then you also have the checks option. So if you have employees that get physical checks, you're going to choose, after the direct deposit, you'll choose the checks option. Whether you use the export or the printing option, you can choose whichever one you normally use. And it will actually give you a file to either import to the software or print off. This is taking a long time. Okay. So anyway, that's what you're going to do as far as your payment processing, to get your check, get your direct deposit, get that information. Maybe. Okay. I'm just going to exit off of this. All right. So we've done our processing of payments. We've got our checks. We've got our direct deposits, et cetera. Now we want to set up our email notices, our email direct deposit notices for the employee. Kind of, I had a little sneak preview of this earlier when I was showing you the posted payroll. But we'll go into the email notices option. And you can see it pulls that up. It pulls in all of the employees that are set for email direct deposits. If I want to send the notices to everyone, I just leave them all there, which I probably do since it's my payroll for 320. Over here, they have to specify. I mean, if they want to process these now, they want to send them out immediately, they're going to probably just leave this alone. And then you have to go down here and specify the bank account. And then there's also, you have the capability of creating like customized direct deposit form files if you want and importing those into the system. And I'll show you how we do that tomorrow when we do reports. But if they had one out there, they would go into the drop-down option here and it would be listed here, like, you know, the names of the report, so the form file. So they could click on that. And then it's going to use that form file and this bank account to pay, you know, to process the direct deposit notices for this. But I'm going to go in. I want to set this. Let's just say that the district sets this to go out on a Friday morning at 2:00 in the morning. So let's just see. This Friday is the 13th. No, I don't want to do that because our pay is the 20th. So let's just do the 21st. I don't know if. Okay, so I set up for 3/21/20, and maybe I wanted to go out at 2:00 in the morning. So at 2:00 a.m., I wanted to go out. All right, so I've got that set for 3/21/20 at 2 a.m. I've got my bank account and my direct deposit form file selected, all of these employees. So I'm going to schedule the sending of the email notices. I'm going to get that scheduled. So sitting out there, whoops, hold on. Oh, I have something extra here. Hold on. Let's try that. I think I had an extra character in there. I did. Okay, it tells me, it gives me a message. 58 email direct deposit notices are scheduled to be sent. Perfect. Now, if you want to, you could go out and make sure that that job is sitting out there ready, you know, sitting there to be processed. So if I go to utilities and I go to the job scheduler, I should see that job sitting out there. Yep, it's right here. payroll 320, 20, the 58 notices, administration. Now, you can go over, you can see all this description as far as this whole process, but if I scroll over, I can see that this is pending. So if I wanted to, I could move like the status over here where the description is at. And maybe I also want to move, oh, let's see, what do I want to move? What do I want to move here? Let's move this next run option over where the description's at. And then we'll move the last run over to where the description. So the description basically is last. So this is pretty much like any of the grids that you have. You can move things around by just basically clicking on it and dragging it and dropping it. So I'm just going to drag this over here and drop it. So now this is a lot better. I like this much better. This grid is better because it's telling me the name of the process, what the status is, when it's going to run, and then once it does run, it's going to say last run. It's going to have that on it. So now, like I said, if for some reason the district had gone in and said, oh, somebody else brought in the time slip, well, I could still add it to this payroll if I wanted to. They probably won't, but if they wanted to, they could. So the first thing, if it was me, I would do, I would go out here and delete this because we don't want these direct deposit notices going out. So I'm going to delete that. I'm just going to hit the delete option. You can see that it's gone. Okay. Now, if I go back to my payroll, I still have the capability of going in and I'm posting this payroll. But you know what? I'm not going to do that yet. Let's just pretend I didn't delete the email direct deposit note. Let's just say I'm going to go out. I'm going to get my my ACH direct deposit pay file set up, created. So I get that created, and I'm going to create, if I have HSAs, I would do the same thing. So I'm going to go in to the reports option and click this ACH submission option, because this is going to allow me to go in and create my direct deposit tape file, submission file, and a report that I can look at first. So we want employee, do we want, can everybody still hear me? Okay. So like I said, we have the capability of creating an ACH submission file or an HSA submission file, either one. I'm going to do the ACH submission file. So here's my pay date. You can see it automatically populated to 320 of 20. And then the ACH source is automatically set up, defined on the records, on the pay distribution records for the employees. And then do I want to include the Social Security number on the tape file? 9 times out of 10, the answer is no. So we're going to go in and change that. And I think that is something that we need to have changed down the road eventually. It's not something that's killing, but it's something that should be changed eventually. So I'm going to go in here, and I'm going to say employee, so SSN will not be included. We don't want to include it. Okay, and then how do we want to sort? How do we want to sort this? Do we want to sort it by employee name, by their number? How do we want to do it? I'm going to do it by name. And then the format. This format option is just for the report because people say the submission file, we can't tell it, you know, that, because the submission file automatically processes in the correct format. But right now, we're just going to do the report. But the first thing I have to do, you can see all these different pay periods are sitting out here. If I wanted to display all the pay periods, the payrolls, I could click this box. I think this is all of them anyway. Well, maybe there isn't. Okay. So all I really want is my 320 payroll. That's what I want to actually create a report for right now. So I'm going to select that. I'm going to click the box next to it. And then I'm going to click the generate report option. when I do that, I'm going to pull that report up. I'm going to look at it because I can actually go into that report and verify the direct deposit total on the bottom to make sure that it matches what was on my pay report. So here's my report, all my employees, but then I should have total, which I do. So my total here should be matching the total that's on my pay report. And I don't know if I have my current payroll report. I do. No, that's error. I'm not going to pull back up, but it should match that payroll report total. If it does, we're in good shape so far. All we have to do now is click the generate submission file option. Now, again, if you have employees that are set up as pre-notes, if you have districts that still do that, they're going to want to go ahead and click this convert pre-notes or ACH submission file generation. Convert pre-notes on ACH submission file generation. So basically, when I generate the submission file, I want to set the pre-notes to live. I'm checking that box. I don't have any pre-notes, but I'm just showing you how you do that. So I'm going to go ahead and click the generate submission file. You can get a little note. All ACH pre-notes associated to the selected payroll have been converted. And then here is my submission file that I'm going to be uploading to the bank. And you can see on that file that our total is down here on the bottom, matches, which is good. So then the district can go in and wherever this file went, when they actually saved it, they can go in then and upload it to their banking website. I don't know what that error is about, but probably something to do with those converting pre-notes. And then if they had HSA submissions to do, again, they would go back in. I'm sorry, I clicked on something incorrectly here. I'll go back to the ACH submission, just so you can see the setup for the HSA. It's pretty similar to the ACH, except all you're doing is creating a submission file. There is no report out there. I know, I think we have a dear issue requesting that a report be added to this so you can actually see the report before you create the submission file. And in here, they just have to choose the ACH source if they had information in there. Because when you're creating the HSAs, you have to have an ACH source for those. So this district obviously doesn't have HSAs. But if they did, you would be choosing the ACH source, clicking the payroll you're processing, and then you click the generate HSA submission file, and that file would get created as well. So let me go back to the payroll processing again. Now you'll say, oh, you can't do that. It's gone. It is gone. But again, I could go to this posted option. And when I go to the posted option, I can just click the detail tab for my payroll. And when I do that, it takes me back to where I was at. Now, I really have done everything on this so far. I don't really need to do anything else at this point. So I've gone in, I've created my ACH submission file. If I had an HSA submission file, I would have created that as well. Okay, I got all that done. Now, what I can do next is I'm gonna go in, I'm gonna process my board distribution. Maybe I need to process my Medicare. We have the option to do that. If you have districts that use that you do their retirement through a foundation payment, you have capability of creating the submission file the upload files for USAS for that, which would be like board rep in Classic. And we also have the capability of doing retirement through employer distributions, which is just like board disk in Classic. So I'm going to go ahead and show you how to do those options. So in order to process your board pay deductions or your employer distributions, as they're called now, we need to go to this USAS integration option. Now, a little bit of background on USPS integration options. Before, if you have a district that's brand new, you have to actually turn this module on. If you don't, you won't even see it on the screen. And to turn it on, I'm just going to kind of jump ahead here and go to the system modules option. We're going to talk about all this tomorrow, but I wanted to show you where this is at. You can see right now, if there's a minus sign in here, that means that that module is turned on, which it is. If I went in here and clicked it and made that a plus sign, you'll see when I hit refresh, that USPS integration tab at the top is going to be gone. It's gone. I can't do anything with that. You'll see it's missing. But I'm going to go ahead and turn it back on because I actually want to use it. Now, a couple modules that you need to turn on as well, if you're doing employer distributions or employer retirement share modules, you have to make sure those are turned on because if you don't, you won't see them in the USPS integration module. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to refresh my screen so I see that. But now, let's just do this. Let me go to the USPS integration module. You can see here I have an employer distribution submission option, an employer retirement share submission option, okay? But if I go to the system module and I basically turn both of these off, which means basically make it a plus sign, refresh the screen. If I do that, go back to the USPS integration tab, you're going to notice those options are gone. They're no more. They're gone. You can also see there's a leave projection submission as well. Same thing holds true with that. If I go back to system, go to module, actually, sorry, up. If I turn the employer distribution module back on and the employer retirement share module back on, and let's just see, there's a leave projection module. That's the one we saw that's available. I turned it off, we wouldn't see it. But those are all on. So now when I refresh, those are all going to be under that USPS integration. Okay, so if I go back here, I can now see my employer distribution submission and employer retirement share submission. They're both back. Now, the first thing that we can do before we actually process these, we can actually go out. There's reports that can be ran that you can verify and look at totals before you actually do the submission to USPS. So if I go out on your report, you can see here there's an employer distributions report. If I click on that, I can go ahead and I can enter the date. So pretty much this is just like Ford did. You're using the pay date. So you're putting in a beginning period, pay date, ending pay date. So if you have districts that do not run employer distributions until the end of every month, they're probably going to use the first pay of the month pay date to the last pay of the month pay date. But I'm just going to do that 320 pay date because that's what I want to process. The pay cycle can be left blank. I always leave it blank. Or you could choose, you know, if it's paid monthly, quarterly, every pay, whatever. If you only want to use employer distribution accounts, it's already defaulted. Check. Now, a lot of times districts have grant accounts that they have set up as not employer distribution accounts. But maybe they want to pay health insurance and dental and vision out of those grant accounts for those particular employees. They can actually do that by leaving the employer distribution flag unchecked on the pay account, and then they could go in here and uncheck this box, because if we have this unchecked, it's going to use all pay accounts for each payroll item that we choose. So like I said, maybe they only want to pay health, dental, and vision out of all the accounts, out of every account, whether it be employer distribution or out of grant accounts. I could go in then and just choose the particular payroll items that I want to be paid out of those, all of the accounts, basically. So let's just say that's my dental, my vision, my health. If those were my three options, I would process that. I don't want to process these because I just basically want to tell you and show you that. That's an option. But let's just say that we're going to process the Medicare. And we don't want Medicare being withheld out of the grant account. We want to make sure that we have use only employer distribution account checked because we only want to pay the Medicare out of those accounts. Now, the thing about it is anything that was paid for out of the grant accounts will get charged to the regular pay account for those particular employees. So what I'm going to do, I have my pay date set. I have my use only employer distribution account set up. If I only want to summarize the individual amounts detail, I can do that. That's the default that is checked. So I'm going to go in, and let's just say I'm only going to run this. I just want to run it for Medicare. That's all I want to do. I'm going to go ahead and click the generate report option. And when I do, I'm just going to go in here and pull up my report. Now, like I said, the nice thing with the report is you could process, if you wanted to play around, you could go in, maybe we were doing our health, dental, and vision. We could go in and process the health, dental, and vision with the box employer distribution accounts checked, and we could do it with the box unchecked, and you could see the difference. But here are all of our totals for all the different accounts and the employee information all on the report. And then we'll have totals at the bottom. So again, this is our employer distribution report. This is like board disk. Then we also have, under reports, you have the capability of running an employer retirement share, which is basically like your board ret report. So we could go in, name it whatever we want. This is totally, you know, you can make changes, make a name change, whatever you want to do. Beginning and ending date, same thing applies, payroll date. You know, if you're doing it for the month, using the first pay date and the last pay date. If you're doing it for each pay, you put in each pay. And then you put in your SRS amount to distribute. I'm just gonna put in a dollar amount. And then we're just gonna click the generate report option. When we do that, we'll get the report. Going to give us all the information that we're then going to actually go in and process for the board. I'll go ahead and pull this report up. And you can see all the account information, all the money that's being prorated, the original amount, the gross amount, and then the proration amount. And then down here, you also have totals as well. And then you can see down here, this was my total of all accounts. I only put $6,000 in, but I'm way out. So actually, once I ran the reports, looked at all those, verified everything, maybe saved them, I'm going to go out here. Now, I'm actually going to post these to USAS because I want USAS to be able to actually take that information and process it on their side. So I go to the USAS integration module. And I'm going to click, let's do the employer distribution submission first. So I'm going to go in here, put in my pay date. And you can tell this is pretty much the same setup as the report was. And here's my use only employer distribution accounts option. I'm going to go in, I'm just going to choose my Medicare for now. If I wanted to do dental vision, some districts do everything all together. Some do it separately, it's however they want to do it. So I'm going to go in, I selected the Medicare. Now I want to click this show submission preview option. The dollar amount, the total amount on here is probably what should match my report that I just processed. Should match the 372127. If it does, I'm actually going to go in now and I'm going to submit this to USAS. Then you'll go out here and you'll actually get the message saying that it was processed successfully to USAS. And then if I go up here, I can actually see that it was sent today and was submitted to USAS. you can see here, there's other reports that were processed. These are ones that I did yesterday, I think. But you can see that the submission was received by USAF and it is pending. So basically, they've gotten it, and what they want to do with it is up to them. If they don't like it, they want to reject it, they can reject it and send it back. It'll actually be a rejected file. You'll see. It'll say rejected. But for right now, we've got this submission file out here. And again, you could do the same thing if your district processes, you know, the board retirement, board paid insurance, anything. They're going to process it through this employer distributions option. And that's where they're going to process all of that through. Now, we can also go in the employer retirement share submission, which is your classic board rest. So we're going to go in here and do the same thing. We're going to put in the pay date or date, you know, if you do it on the monthly basis. And then we'll put in our dollar amount. We'll take it a little higher. I'm going to hit my show submission review option. When I do that, this takes a few more seconds than the employer distribution because there's so much data being pulled in. So it takes a few more seconds. But you can see here, all of my information is being pulled in for all the different accounts, for my SCRS and SCRS, all the dollar amounts for each account. And then if I'm happy with everything, I'm going to go ahead and click the Submit Employer Share of Retirement to USAF. And when I do that, it tells me that it was sent successfully to USAF. And again, just like employer distribution, I should be able to see the file that I just sent, which is this one right here. It was sent today. It was submitted to USAF. There's other ones that have already been received. Maybe they're still pending. Maybe they've already been processed. This is where we're going to see all that information. So again, this is a really nice feature. Do it just like you did in Classic Board Ret or Board Div, either one. Now that we've done that, okay, again, we're still okay if we wanted to unpost the payroll. If USAF hasn't posted anything yet, if they've posted anything with your retirement submission or your employer distribution, or there's one other thing that we haven't done yet, which is submit the payroll to USAF. And in order to do that, that's another USAF integration option as well. And you can see right here, there's a payroll submission option. You just click that payroll submission option. And when I do that, I'm gonna see all the payrolls that have been processed. But over here, it's telling me which ones haven't been sent, which ones have. Because when they have, you can see the view details option. But this is my 320 payroll that I just did today. So I want to post that to USAF. Those other ones, I don't want to post them. I just want to ignore them. I'm going to post this one to USAF for today. So when I click that post to USAF, you're going to see that the posting status right now, it says nonsense, not sent. Down here, you can see my payroll total. That total should match what was on my pay report. At the bottom of the pay report, it should match. Okay, once everything looks accurate, I could check all my accounts if I wanted to make sure the totals are all right. Once everything looks correct, it looks good, I'm going to go ahead and click this Submit to USAF option. When I do that, it tells me that the posting status is sent, when it was sent, the time, the latest status, and then any messages. So basically submitted into USAF. Then I could go to return to the payroll listing. You can see here that it's been posted to USAF. And again, if they want to reject it, like I said, maybe you decided, oh my gosh, I need to unpost it. I run over to the USAF and go, don't do anything with the files that I've just sent to you. Payroll, nothing, just ignore them, reject them. They can do that. They can reject all those files. You could go back into payroll and you could actually go in and unpost. At this point, you can still unpost. But again, you have to make sure that they haven't processed anything in USAF before you unpost it, because you don't want to make a mess. So at this point, I could go in if I wanted to, and still on post as long as nothing is processed through USAS yet. So if nothing's processed through USAS, I could actually on post. And then again, I'd be basically re-going through everything that I've just done at this point. Okay. The next thing that we're going to talk about is the outstanding payables, which is basically like your pay debt in Classic. It's like running your deduction report, creating your checks for your deductions if necessary. So we're going to go in order to get to that, we need to go to the processing tab. And there's a process outstanding payables option. That's going to be your deductions, your payables, your payroll items that you need to pay. You can see across the top here, there are different tabs. All these tabs are basically what you're seeing on this grid. So right now I have payables by payee. So it's just got the code, the amount, and the employer amount. If I chose the payables by item type, it gives me a little bit more information on my grid. Let's just say I wanted to move. I think I can move. Yeah, I can. The participant's over. I wanted my grid to look different. Like I said, anytime you have a grid, you can move things around the way you want it. But then now you'll see that there's participants, employee amount, and code. If I go to the payables by item detail, it should give me even more options on my grid. And as we pull more options, it takes a few more seconds. And you'll notice now we've got the code, employee amount, employer amount. We've got now the employee's name information. We've got their employee's number, their position number. So if I wanted to, I want to only see information for Nick Schroeder. I should be able to put his name in there or part of his name and only see all of the payroll items that are in reference to Nick Schroeder. Or if I wanted to use the number to filter, I could do that as well. I'll go ahead and exit off that, pull everything back up. If I wanted to see the payroll items by full detail, that pretty much gives you everything that's on this screen. Plus, it also gives you pay dates. So maybe you have payroll items that haven't been paid from last pay. You know, you have items that are processed every pay for the employees, but you don't pay them to the vendor until the second pay. Maybe they're monthly. So those pay dates may be out there. You might have a pay date, last pay date, plus the current pay date sitting out there when you're doing monthly. Oh, I didn't click it. No wonder it didn't come up. I'm like, where's the painting? Okay, now we will get it. Somebody's asking about the mapping screen. And yeah, it does come into play. Employer distribution, yes. And as far as the question is, does mapping come into play with only the employer distribution submission or also the employer retirement share submission? And it should come into play for both, either or. So, and we'll talk about mapping in a little bit. I didn't tell you where that was at, but we do have a mapping option as well. I'll tell you that in a few minutes. But it should come into play for both options, for the employer distribution as well as the employer retirement share distribution. So here again, here are all of the payroll items by full detail. And you'll see here is the pay date. So again, if I wanted to, I could filter by the pay date only. If I wanted to filter by a particular employee, I could filter however I wanted to filter on the grid. What I want to do first, let's just say that I'm only processing payables for the month. So I'm going to go in. I want to look at my pay report. So basically in Classic, it would have been your deduction detail report. This payable reports option is what you're going to be using for that deduction detail report. And if you, just a heads up, if you don't process this before you process your outstanding payable, you're not going to see anything. They're not going to be out there because you've actually paid them. So we want to make sure we choose the payable report first. And you can run this a variety of ways. Like if I wanted to pull in only the items that were paid every payroll, I could do that. Or if I only wanted to pull in the items that were paid monthly, I could do that by just selecting the monthly option. Or if I just want to pull in pretty much everything that is out there right now to be paid on the outstanding payable screen, I'm going to just leave the selected field blank over here and then just process it. Just create it for everything. But let's just say that I'm only going to do it for everything that's every payroll. I don't know if I even have anything set up in this test account with every payroll. But we'll run it. We'll see. We'll find out real quick. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and pull up my payables item detail report. Yep, I do have a couple things. Obviously, my federal tax. This is everything that gets paid on a daily, on every payroll basis. And actually, that's probably all I'm going to want to pull up because I don't want to pay everything month that's paid monthly because it's not the end of the month yet. This is my first payroll, so I'm not going to be paying that for that. So I would save that payable report somewhere special. And then if I wanted to, I could also create a summary report. The summary report is pretty much like your pay debt report with your totals for each particular payroll item that you're paying. So I'm just going to go ahead and process that. And again, you can see here are all of my different payroll items that I'm going to be paying this payroll. Now, one thing that you'll notice, even though there is something that's employer paid, it still shows up on this report. We've discovered, actually, one of the ITCs discovered that there were some things that just the board paid. And when the payroll archive reports are created, basically, those are created when you're actually processing through the payroll. So when you're actually processing the report, it's going out to the payroll archive, just like it did in the payroll CD. But we noticed that there were a few items that were on this payable summary report that were on here when you looked at it, or the report that you saved. But for some reason, they didn't go out to the payroll archive. And we're going to fix that. We want it to be available out there so you can easily go in and open up that report and say, oh yeah, for the board share of SCRS for the 400 records, X amount of dollars was paid on the 320 pay. I mean, that's just an easy way to see it. Instead of, you know, having things missing, we are going to fix that. So I've gone in and I've basically processed my detail report and my summary report. Again, on these reports, you could do a page break, just like you could in class if you wanted to, for payroll item code. The choice is yours, however you want to process it. So once you've gone through and created these reports, processed these reports, we can then go in and actually pay the actual payroll item. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to click every payroll because I only want to pay all the payroll items that are processed every payroll. I probably should just go back to payables by KE. I don't care about the payables by item full detail. I don't want to filter anything right now. I just want to pay those particular items. So I'm going to go back to the payables by KE. It breaks it down, makes it a little easier to see. And again, because these are payroll items, sometimes it takes a few more minutes to pull in. Let me select the every payroll again. And again, here are all of my items that get paid every payroll. So these are the items that I'm going to pay. to pay them, I have to make sure that I choose them. I could choose them one by one if I wanted to, or if I just click this box underneath the available box above, it'll select all of the items all at the same time. So at this point, all of these items are going to be paid. And you can see they pulled over to the select payable detail option. You can see there's a couple of them. These are board pay. This College Park software, Mountain Zion landscaping, and the Statesboro landscaping. You can see those are board pay payroll items, but they just pull over. They're not going to be paid through the payroll system. They're just pulling over to the payable detail option. Now over here, we have the capability of viewing by pay, by per payee, which it is defaulted to, or if we wanted per item detail, which basically just breaks it down, gives you a little more detail about everything that's being paid underneath that particular payee. I'm just gonna go back to the payee option. Once I do that, I need to click the post option. When I click the post option, it's gonna pop up a box. And basically, it already defaults to today's date for the issue date. Now, if for some reason you were processing this, maybe you weren't finished with February yet, and you had a payroll in February, right at the end of February, and let's just say that you were just now processing the payables for that pay. More than likely, what's going to happen is because those have a February date, I take that back. If you're in March posting period, never mind. You'll be okay. If you were still in February posting period, but you were using a March issue date, you're going to get an error message stating that the issue, you're not in the correct posting period. Just an FYI, so you know that. And then you have your bank account option. Again, if you know, your payroll items are paid out of a different bank account than your payroll, you would choose that particular bank account. And then the output format, whether it be an XML format or PDF format, whether you're in the print them out or create a file. So we're just gonna do the PDF format because what's gonna happen is you're actually gonna go into a different screen to actually create the check, the XML file for the payments. So what I'm doing is I'm just going into the PDF option, the print option, so I can use the starting check number, which automatically defaults to the highest check number available. And then I'm just clicking the post option. But I clicked it, yeah. And again, this takes a couple seconds. And while this is doing that, like I said, we're going to create this, but when we do, all we're going to get from here is a report. Pretty much it's going to look like that summary report that we saw earlier. But if I want to go in and actually process any physical checks that need to be processed for those payroll items, I need to go into payments and I need to go to the payee option. When I go to the payee option, I need to go to the payee payments checks option. And then I'm going to filter because all I want to do is create the XML file for my check printing software for checks that were basically created for that 320 pay. So I have the issue date, which was 311. That's today's date. That's when they were basically, it was issued. So I'm going to go in and filter by that issue date of 311-2020. So this gives me all the physical checks that I need to process for the pay for those particular payroll items. So in order to create those texts or to create the file, I need to go in and select, again, I can select them separately if I wanted to, or I could just click the box under the reissue tab, and this will check, it will select all of the boxes, everybody, all those payroll items are going to be changed. At this point, you'll notice now, these tabs at the across the top, the reissue, current checks, and resequence, all are now available. They're highlighted. I can actually access them. I'm going to choose the print checks option. When I do that, I get a box asking me my output format. So I want to choose XML because I'm going to create an XML file that I'm going to import to my printing software. And you'll see the file name is automatically default text.xml. That could be changed if you wanted to. You could type something in there, you know, the payday or whatever you want to call it, because that file is going to be going over to your directory or wherever you save it. And then once I go ahead and click the process payments option, again, I can select where I want that XML file to go. I'm going to go ahead and click that text.xml file, and I'll be able to see my file. Actually, that I'm going to be importing into my check printing software. So here's my file that I'm going to be using. Okay. Now, if for some reason, let me go back to the PDF option. I just want to show you that. And then again, if you're printing off checks, there's a print checks option. So like if you're printing off like direct deposit notices, you may have a custom form file that you're going to use. So you could select that from the form option here. And then you need to click the process payments once you've chosen the PDF option. And we'll see if we got anything here. Yep, got a couple things. So here is what, you know, like again, if you had direct deposit notices that you sent out, you could be using a customized form file that actually has the information on it, and it will actually show you the information. But again, these are payroll checks, so, or not payroll, payee checks. Got to say the right thing. So you could be processing these checks as PDF if you're using a PDF. I think like ABM, created check, those use the PDF format. So you may be using this option instead of the XML option. Okay. So now we've processed our outstanding payables. We've done all that. We do have, I'll go back and we'll talk about the mapping a little bit. The mapping can be found under the utilities option. It's called account mapping. I'm just going to go ahead and click on that. And you can see here, you can actually go in. It's pretty much like plastic. You're putting in the original benefit account that they were charged, that they were to be charged out of, and the account that you want it to be charged out of. You want to map it to. You can actually use that as well. To create a mapping, you just have to click this plus button at the bottom. And then you can see here, it actually gives you a blank area to put it. Now, if I didn't want that, I could just get rid of it by clicking the X. Or maybe I want to move something. Maybe I wanted to move this one up to the top. So all I need to do is drag and, drag it, there we go, and drop it. So I moved it. So I can reorder it any way I want to. Can move it back down to the middle if I wanted it there. I can click on it here. There we go. So that's pretty much your mapping. Again, it's very similar to classic, but there's kind of like some better features because it allows you to like move things around. If you create a new account and you needed to move it up higher, you know, in the hierarchy, you can do that by just dropping, dragging, and dropping. So that is definitely your mapping option. And again, like we had asked earlier, when you're processing employer distributions or employer retirement sales admission, both of those options will be looking at your mapping. They should both be looking at mapping. So if you're doing that and you have accounts mapped to a different account, you can definitely do that. And the employer distributions and employer retirement share will be actually looking at that. Another thing that we want to talk about, payroll processing, would be your retirement report. So if we went back to the reports option again, you go down here, you can see we have an SERS for pay report. So we're going to go ahead and do that one first. And then what we can do is we can go in and if we want to change the report title name, we can for the report. I'm just going to leave it at SERS for pay report. And then we can choose how we want to sort. So if we want to sort by name, number, code, date, whatever, we can do that. I'm just going to choose by name because that's kind of how I roll. I always do by name. And then we have the option to begin each employee on the new page. You can see that's not defaulted. But the show detail on report and show informational messages on report are checked. So basically, if there's any informational messages, they'll show on this report. And the detail will show as well. If we had adjustments, we need to check this generate submission file for adjustments only. So basically, if you had adjustments, like in Classic where we had a regular file, if we had an adjustment file that got created, if you needed the adjustment file, you're going to have to go and separately generate that submission file just for the adjustment. And then do we want to set employees with submission file as reported to SERS? Yes. So when we create the submission file, we're going to actually update it, just like Classic did, that it's been reported to SERS. So the first thing I need to do is not going to do anything unless I give it some dates and give it the pay cycle information and the pay cycle code information. So the first thing I have to do is put in the pay date. So I'm going to scroll down, and I can see all the historical pays. I can see this is the last payroll that I processed, okay? So I'm going to go in and put that date in of 3/20/20. Oh, maybe I better. I click on the right box. Okay, then I'm going to put a code, or the cycle and then the code. Now I have to make sure I put in my period beginning days, my period ending days. Once I've done that, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to click, I'm going to click the generate report option because I want to generate a report for this particular pay period. So I can get a report and look at it, verify everybody has days and hours, and verify my totals, balance, make sure everything is kosher with my payroll item report, you know, as far as like how much was withheld and things like that. So again, I go through and I make sure, you know, everybody has days and hours. Oh, gosh, he doesn't have any hours. Neither does she. Okay, that's easily fixed. Kelsey Bernard and Heidi Cherry don't have hours. There's a bunch of them that don't. But we're going to just, for the names that we're just going to do Kelsey for right now. So what I can do is I could go in to the core. And I could go to the adjustment screen. And then when I go to adjustments, what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be creating an adjustment for the SERS hours for Kelsey Bernard. And how I'm going to do that, as soon as the adjustment screen pops up, because it takes a few minutes, again, because it looks at payroll items, it takes a couple extra minutes for the screen to pull up. Hopefully, down the street in the future, that will be corrected. We're going to be making changes to make that a little bit better. Well, it's taking a while longer than I thought it would. Okay, here we go. So I'm going to go in, I'm going to create an option. And we had Kelsey Bernard. So I was going to try to find her. Kelsey. And then because there's really not a payroll item involved, I don't have to select a payroll item. I just basically need to go in and adjust for FERS hours. So I just need to go down to the type field. And I need to scroll down so I can find the FERS retirement hours option. And then I need to put in a date. I'm just going to put in today, 3-1. Yeah, I can put in today's date because that's within the period beginning and ending date of the payroll. Again, if you're doing adjustments, you have to use a date within the period beginning and ending date of your payroll, not the pay date. It's a little different than classic ones. And then you're going to put in the amount of hours. So let's just say she has 25 hours. We could put a description if we wanted to. Oops. Gosh. There we go. And then once we do that, we're going to go in and we're going to, what am I doing? Am I? There we go. Ah, am I? Okay. Okay, am I? All right, now we can go ahead and click the save option. And you notice here, we have that create new option available here as well. A lot of the screens have it. Okay. What? Closing here isn't open. Oh, can anybody see what I did wrong? It's giving me an error, but I, you know why it is? Exactly. Marge, you're exactly right. It's the year. So we're going to go in and we're going to correct that. And that's exactly what I want. I wanted to see, because we had an error, I wanted you guys to see that that happens. And the system won't allow you just to put junk in. It won't allow you just to put anything in there. So we're going to go in and fix the year. Once I do that, I'm going to go ahead and click save. When I click save now, it should save the record. Okay, and it did. So now what I can do is I could go back to report and I could rerun that SARS per pay report. And when I do that, now Kelsey Bernard should show hours on the report. So I got to go back in and set up the screen again. All right, and then I'm going to go ahead and click the generate report option. Maybe I can get up to that screen. There we go. And when we pull Kelsey or pull the report up now, Kelsey should show with the adjustment hours that we added. So again, districts are not lost. It's pretty much like classic when you're doing adjusting entries for retirement hours. In classic, you're doing the same thing here. What is this doing now? Oh, no, that's right. Okay, I'm not quite sure why it did that, because this is just an informational message. But that really shouldn't be on there, because the 3/11 date is within my period beginning and ending days. But I will run that back with the programmers, because that definitely shouldn't be happening, because it's within our pay date range, our period range. So we should be okay with that. And you can see here, it put the 25 hours in, but it put it in on a separate line as the earnings code 51. That's not right. Okay, I wonder, let me go back. I'm going to try something once. Maybe I do need to use the pay date. We're kind of in the midst of things. We're changing things, and we're trying to get that so it'll recognize prior dates. And right now, that isn't right. But let me try putting in the pay date like we do in classic right now and see if it makes a difference. Let's see. Let's put the 20th in here and see what happens. We'll save it. Okay, got that saved. Modify the record. I'll go back to the SARS report again. The per pay. And again, I have to put all my information in. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and generate through. Oops, yeah, it doesn't like the date. Because I have dots instead of the slashes. Ruger, quiet. All right, let's try this again. I'm going to generate the report. Observation of pay date something. I did choose the pay date. Try this again. Okay. 3/1/14. Generate. Let's try it again. Oh, it's just processing. It just takes a few minutes. Actually, that error I think was from before, from when I had the dots instead of the slashes in. But I could see it's processing. You can see that blue line across the top. That means it's processing. Oh, it's processing again, probably because I clicked it again. Okay, what is going on? Let's try one more time. There we go. That's what I want to see. I want to look at the old report. I want to look at the new report. See if it makes a difference that we're using the pages. We may need to talk to the programmers about that. Yep, that's not working. Yeah, it took the error away, but it didn't give me the hour or the, yeah, it didn't give me the hours. We may need to talk to the programmers about that one. Like I said, I know they're good. They've been working on those things. And so maybe there's something not quite right with that. Yeah. Oh, she doesn't have Dave paid either. Yeah. Well, I'll check into that and make sure. Because, again, we should be able to go into adjustments and just make retirement day adjustments, retirement hour adjustments. And it should pull in that data correctly. And then again, we have the same thing for STRS under reports. We have an STRS report, and there have been many requests to have this be uniform. So basically, make it say STRS per pay report, just like we have the STRS per pay. And again, you can see it kind of works the same way. You're creating the report. It's a little different though, because what you can do is generate your report. I'm just going to go in and choose this payroll, and I'm going to generate the report. But you can see there's other options on this screen where you can actually create the file submission and then upload it, or you can just do everything in one big swoop. You can create the file and submit it to STRS all at the same time. So here's all of our STRS information again. You know, they're going to want to check the totals, make sure everything looks correct. If it does, like I said, you could do this create submission file option, save the file out to wherever they want to save it, and then upload it to STRS. Or they can click this generate submission file and submit to STRS option, which does it, again, in one big swoop. Or they could choose to create the file, then choose the file, then click the submit upload file to STRS. They want to do those two options instead. So there's a variety of ways they can do things as far as the submission option. At this point, let me make sure there is nothing else we kind of need to talk about as far as payroll processing. Okay, payroll processing, I think we've kind of gone through pretty much everything. Another thing I wanted to show you, we have the benefits processing option, which is like your benefit in Classic. So if we go to the processing tab and click the benefit update and projection option, there's a variety of options on here. So again, it's kind of like Benac, there's several different choices. So obviously every month you districts do an accrual for benefits. Here's where they'll be doing those accruals. So you can have the accrual tab selected. They can go in, rename this report if they want to. There's a projection option and an actual option. We always suggest running it projection first in case there's any errors or something needs to be fixed. You can select the leave that you want to accrue, whether it be sick or vacation or all leave. You can choose either one. If you want to do one at a time, you can. Then you can put in your specific accrual date. So I will just put in, I'll just do this, 3/15 of 20. And then do I want to include in eligible positions? Just like we have in Classic, we have that flag in here as well. If you did, you would check the box, click on it. And then how do we want to sort? Do we want to sort by the number or by the employee's name? Then you have the capability of going in and either selecting particular pay groups, the particular pay group or groups that you want to do the accrual for, or particular employee or employees that you want to do it for. Now, if I wanted to select all the pay groups, again, I could click the very first one, hold my shift button, scroll down, click the last one. All of them, you'll notice, are highlighted. Then I can move everything over to the right, to the selected box, to do the same thing with the employees if I needed to. From here, I'm going to go ahead and click the generate report option. This is going to give me my benefit report, what's going to happen, you know, what their old balance is, what their new balance is going to be. So if I go in and take a look at that report when it finishes processing, it's going to show me the old balance and the new balance for the 60. Oops, because that's all I chose was my sick. So here's my sick leave balance, the accumulation, and then the new balance. So let's take a look at Daniel Gomez. Currently, he has 43.25 hours, okay? But when we actually run this in actual, he's gonna have 44.5. So we're gonna go ahead, let's go look at him and leave, just to verify, to make sure. So we'll go to the core leaves option. We'll pull him up. Okay, we'll pull up his name, M-E-V. We want to look just at the sick leave. So we're going to pull that up. And you can see 43.25, that's what we saw in the report. That's good, everything matches. So I'm gonna go back to the processing tab and I'm gonna click on the update and projection option again, but this time I'm gonna run in actual. I'm actually gonna update that. So again, I could, you know, make this, put the date on it, 3/15/20, benefit accrual report. You know, when I ran initially, I could have put initial or projection report. Or now I could put actual. And then I'm going to go and just change my accrual projection to accrual. Leave the sick leave. Again, I have to put in my date. If I want to select all the pay groups, I could just leave it blank. Or like I said, I could click on the first one, hold my shift key down, scroll down, click the last one, and then pull them all over. And now all I need to do is go in and click the generate report option. Now that I'm running it in an actual or accrual, it's gonna accrue benefits for those employees. So we'll go back and look at Garcia, and we should notice that his sick leave benefit has changed to 44.5. Okay, so the processing is done. Let's go to the leaves again. And we should be able to see Oops, I think I typed this wrong. RPI. What is this thing here? Come on. I want to do this. Let me get rid of that. PARPA. Okay. What are you doing? Hold on. Let me get out of here once. Let me go back. Sorry about that. I don't know what the thing was doing. Okay, what happened to him? He disappeared. What is going on? Hold on, let me look at my report again. Okay, I'm totally losing it. I swear Garcia was my person. I'm not seeing him. What in the world happened? Okay, let's just look at the report, the actual report. All right, so let's look at Alice Hyde. She should now have 24.5 days. There we go. Look at her sick. 24.5. Of course, I probably picked some weird, wacky person to look at, but this person, we can see that her accrual actually changed on her sick, 24.5. And again, like I said, they could do it for vacation and sick together, separately if they want to, however they want to process. Now, if we go back to the benefit update and projection option under processing, you can see we have other tabs as well. So we have that reset personal leave tab. So just like in classic, where we have the reset personal leave option, normally that's only done usually maybe at like the beginning of the school year or maybe right before the beginning of the incoming school year. So they're going to basically use that same option here. It would reset the personal leave, specify the date. They can choose how they want to sort the report. And again, they can run a projection report or run the actual reset. We have the convert personal leave to pay. So basically, towards the end of the summer, when they're going to pay out, if the district pays out personal leave as unused, if they pay that out, we're going to use this option. So they can set this up to run that process to actually pay those employees for unused personal leave days if they do that. And you can see all the setup options are pretty much just like we have in Classic as far as like the convert personal leave option. Do we want to use the flat rate or do we want to use the position rate that's on their compensation record? The percent of balance to convert, are we converting 100%, 50%, whatever? Is there a minimum balance to qualify? Maybe they have to have one in order to basically pay them. They can't have anything under one. We'd have to set that up. Are there particular appointment types that we're doing this for? Certified, classified, or are we choosing everybody? Is there a specific contract start and stop date? So maybe we don't want to pay it to anybody that just started this year. There's all those multiple options. Then we can select the different pay groups and you can process it that way. And then, like I said, you could run it in projection, which is recommended, and then run it in actual to get your actual projection process. Now you'll notice here, we have the post to future option already defaulted, it's checked. That basically means if you have any employees that have unused personal leave and you're paying them for that leave during this time, that it's actually going to post that entry out in the future. So on the next payroll, they'll get paid that. If you leave it unchecked, then they have to manually enter that information in future or current, wherever they want to add it. And then we also have the box set the personal leave balance to zero checked as well, defaulted, because once you've gone in and paid these employees for that personal leave, you want it back down to zero because you don't want them to have a balance. So you can reset the personal leave before the beginning of the school year. And the same thing holds true here. We have a convert personal leave to sick leave. So basically you're taking any unused personal leave and pushing it over to to sick leave. So we have pretty much this kind of the same setup screen as we do in Classic. There's, you know, still those same options. We have all these different little extra things that include partial days and hours. If you want that, then you check it. If you want to include positions that are ineligible for personal leave, you check it. Or include a position that's ineligible for sick leave, you can check that. Again, they can run it in projection first, which is recommended. We have the create personal leave option, which is what you want to, you can select whether you want to convert one personal leave day to a sick day, convert 50% of the unused personal leave to sick days, convert the unused personal leave balance minus one sick day, minus one to six days, and then you want to carry over personal leave day and convert the remainder of the personal leave day minus one to sick days. So there's all those different options that you can choose. So again, run this in projection, verify what it's going to do before they run it in actual. Run it in actual, it'll actually change those personal leave days six, whichever option they choose. Then we have the part-time leave accrual option, which is basically like the mass, can't remember the name of it in Classic. It's for employees that are marked as part-time on the employee record, and they basically get tracked by the hours that they work and they have benefits set up accordingly because of the law that was set back in, I don't know, 5-10 years ago. So basically we have this part-time leave accrual option. So those people basically are set up to accrue on their part-time basis on hours. And so we go in and we can, again, change the title. We could run it in projection first, how we'd want to sort it, and then which pay groups we want to process it for. When we generate it, for fun, let's just generate it, see if we have any part-time employees in this test database. Not sure if we do or not. We probably do, but we'll find out. Go ahead, Jerry. If I would have left those over in the available box and just select generate report, it would have just processed all the pay groups. It's basically doing the same thing as if I'm selecting all the pay groups. So here's my report, my part-time employee report. We'll see if there's anyone on. Nope. So obviously they don't have any part-time employees in this test database. But if you did, which districts a lot of times do, they would be running this process to basically accrue that for leave. And then also it would remove, you know, the hours that basically build up because they had to reach like so many hours before it'll actually accrue a personal day or whatever. So those are all of the options in the benefit accrual. Then we also have the leave projection option. We have a leave projection report, which is out here under reports. It's called leave projection report. You can see here, we do have a leave balance report as well. So if you needed to run the leave balance report before and after, you could do that. We're going to go ahead, before you ran your accruals or whatever, you could do that. Or if somebody just wanted to see their leave projection report, like a total with everybody on it, say if somebody needs to see that, you could process that report. I'll go ahead and run that so you can see what it looks like. I'm going to sort it by the employee name. You do it by pay group number. Do we want a page break? Do we want page break? If we did it by pay group, we could do that. And then we want all leave types. We want to include ineligible employees. I want to do everybody. I'm not going to select them all. I'm just going to leave this blank. Like I said, if I leave it blank, it's going to give me everyone. It's basically like I'm already selecting all of the pay groups to process. So So I'm going to go ahead and process that report and pull it up. And so on this report, I can see everybody's balances. I can see their name, their pay group, building, their sick leave, vacation, and personal leave. And you can see it's sorted by pay group because I had one, then two. Oh, it separated, it broke by pay group. Doesn't keep them in numerical order, but it does separate by pay group. So that is an option. Excellent. I see it. Rover, be quiet. Sorry. I thought I had her contained down in the basement, but you can still hear her. Okay. The last thing we'll do is the leave projections. Again, we have a leave projection report that can be processed first. So we're going to go ahead and run that report. Again, that title can be changed. And then if they do it like for the month, they could put in the beginning date of the month and the ending date. And then we want to select all the leave types. And you can see down here we have different reports. We have an account summary report that you can create, an account detail report, an employee detail report, and then we have an error message only report. So let's go ahead and do the generate employee detail report first. And we'll just take a look at that. I want to scroll down. And I got all kinds of errors because the account doesn't exist or isn't synced with USPS. So basically, if that's the case, if I had errors, I'm going to have to go in and make those corrections to the errors before I actually can post the leave on the USPS side. So what it's telling me is that those accounts weren't synced. So to sync the account, I would go to the USPS integration. You can see this account synchronization option. When I click on that, I need to click the synchronize accounts with USPS tab. I'm not going to do it because it usually takes a few minutes, but what happens is, and a lot of times districts get impatient, you click on this, and what happens is there's like sets. There's lots of sets of accounts. They go in sets. I think this one here, it has like 38 sets, but there's like several accounts in each set. So it takes a while for that to process through. But districts get impatient thinking, oh, I clicked on, okay, I'm good to go. Well, they have to wait because when they click that synchronize accounts with USPS, it'll tell you it's been submitted to USPS. Then pretty soon you'll get a message. I don't think I can do it because I already did it, but let me just see what it says. Yeah. Yeah, it says submitted to USPS. But then what's going to happen is there's a message that's going to pop up, and it's going to actually start processing, and it'll tell you like 1 of 38 completed, 3 of 38 completed. Like I said, the 38 are sets of accounts, not meaning like there's one account in each one. Right here, there's your error, there's your message. The account synchronization is in progress. So it's telling me it's updating all those accounts. So once that's done, I should be able to go back in and make that, you know, go in and rerun the leave pro or leave report, and it should be corrected. When that happens, when a leave report is good, there's no errors left on it, then I can actually go in to this USPS integration tab. And you can see we have a leave projection submission option. So they're going to want to run the report first. It's just like they did in Classic. They're running the leave pro report first, processing it. But in here, you don't have to create a submission file, like a batch file, like we did in Classic. In here, you just go to the USPS integration option, and you put in your date. And you have, obviously, again, the selected leave types are defaulted to personal, sick, and vacation. If the district didn't want, let's just say, personal, they could just double click and move it over to the available. They could just move over whichever types of leave they want to pull in. When they've done that, they're going to go ahead and click that show submission preview option. And this is pretty much just like when we were doing employer distributions, retirement share submission, you can see the same thing happening here. It'll pull up all the account information, the description, the amount, etc. Then you can actually, you'll get a tab once everything's processed. It'll give you the amount. You'll get that tab at the bottom where you can actually generate that submission file to be processed to go out to USAS. So it's pretty much, it's kind of like very similar screens to employer distribution and retirement submission. Same kind of options, same kind of formatting. So I think that's pretty much everything as far as the payroll processing. Now, I'm going to open it up. Does anybody have questions or anything? And somebody chatted with me. Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. They said, was it Gomez? And I'm thinking you're right. I was looking for Garcia for some reason. And so, yeah, that's not good. Somebody asked, how do you post the foundation payments? Okay, the USAS integration, the employer retirement share submission, that's just like the board rep portion in Classic. Board rep was always processed through USAS. Now it's processed through payroll. The retirement submission is processed through payroll. You're creating all that to submit to USAS. Now they still have to basically accept that information. So that, I'm not sure how USAS handles that part of it, but I'm sure that they'll be talking about that when they have their meeting. Is it next week, I think? But as far as like getting the submission files created, it's out here under the employer share of retirement submission. That's like your board rep. That's your foundation payment. Are there any other questions? Okay, if there's no other questions, I will go ahead and stop the meeting, and I really appreciate everybody tuning in. I hope everybody got something out of this session, and I will get the CEU sent out to you probably sometime this afternoon. Thank you everybody for joining, and have a great day. We'll talk to you later.